Okay, so today we're going to start with exercise 209, which I love calling fuzzy objects, but obviously fuzzy has more to do with the material than anything else. But the point is that today is the day where we learn how to do things like pillows and curtains and cloth-based objects, not rectangles, not extrusions, right? Things that are more organic in shape. And I think one of the temptations when you have a program like Rhino is you end up being able to create pretty much anything you could possibly dream up is capable of being modeled in Rhino. Thus far, everything that we've done has relatively rigid structure to it, right? We extruded walls. Last class, we built a window. Even when we did the sweeps, they were relatively controlled. You know, we had a control curve and then we did a sweep. This is much more in the realm of, you know, creating things that don't have specific numeric values to them. Right, there's not you don't you know, throw your bed sheet on and, you know, measure the wrinkles and they're evenly 2 inches apart or something. You know, it doesn't work that way. It just kind of exists, right? There are wrinkles, so we have to learn how to model those kinds of things in Rhino. And one of the biggest challenges in 3D modeling is making things look real, right? Making a curtain look like it is actually a curtain. We don't have the luxury of gravity in Rhino. Things float. So we can't use that to our advantage. And one of the easiest ways of doing this is to just observe how things naturally look. So if you're modeling a bed, for example, look at what the sheets look like on a bed. Look at how the wrinkles kind of naturally fall. And that can help you in how you choose to model something, right? Look at the way the curtains are. I mean, we've got curtains in those two offices next door, and you can kind of get a sense for what the curtains look like and how the folds of the fabric work. So you want to be aware of your surroundings as a big part of doing these kinds of objects, because if you're not aware of how things naturally look, no matter how much you try to make them look natural, they won't, right? So you have to be aware of kind of, you know, what's going on in a particular object such that we can make it work. So I'm going to start with a relatively simple cushion that has some structure to it that's similar to what we've been doing. So I just have a brand new Rhino file open that is an inches template. And I'm going to show you kind of as an evolution of how I can get to a more organic shape than just a standard cushion. So if, say, I was doing a couch cushion, right? If it was a rectilinear couch cushion, I would start, you know, with maybe a box tool, and maybe we'd go, 24 inches by 18 inches. By 4 inches thick, right? Something like that. But if I were to look at this object, I'd have a very flat box-like object. Now I could soften it a bit. Maybe I'd do a fillet surface. And you don't have to follow along with this. I'm just demonstrating as we go. Fillet surface. I don't know, 1 inch radius, and we could soften each edge. Oh, come on. You know, and then I could soften this edge. And maybe, you know, once I trimmed up those corners, it might look okay, right? But it's really still not that organic of a shape. So instead, I want to start thinking of this not in terms of a solid object or a pre-made object, but a set of curves that can start to define the object. So if I were to define a cushion, rather than start with a square object with square corners, maybe I'd draw that object. So maybe we'll start with a rectangle instead. So let me start at 0, 0, and I'll use the same general dimensions here at 24 inches by 18 inches for the couch cushion. Doesn't really matter what you end up picking, but somewhere in this vein. And if I were looking at this almost as a plan view of my cushion, right? Obviously the corners would be too sharp right now, so maybe I'd round the corners over. So let's use a fillet, and let's do a radius of, oh, I don't know, maybe a half inch. And I could actually kind of round those over a little bit. Something like that. There we go. And maybe if I looked at it in the top view, this would help, right? So there's my cushion. The corners are kind of rounded. That's pretty good. But it would be nice if there was a little bit of maybe a wave to the sides, right? So it wasn't quite so strict just yet. So if I look at this surface, right now I created it as a rectangle,
but it is in fact made up of a bunch of individual curves. So if I were to go to explode, I think it's under edit and then explode there, I'd end up creating a bunch of kind of individual little objects. Okay, and so I could take an object like this, and this straight line by default is made up of 2 points, one at either end with a straight line between them. Okay, so if I were to come over here and I were to turn my points on, we'd see that I have a point at this end and a point at this end that define that object. Okay? If I want the object to be a little bit wavy, right, I need to change the number of control points that make up this object. So I'm going to take this line and I'm going to rebuild it. And I think it's under transform, but I always type rebuild. It might be under edit. It's under edit rebuild. And here I get this little rebuild dialog box that let me control the point count. So right now in parentheses it's telling me that I have 2 points. Okay? If I were to change this and make it 4 points, right, I'd have a point on either end and I'd have a couple points in the middle. That doesn't sound bad. Maybe an odd number is better, so maybe I'll do 5 points. Right? Below that I have something called degree. And a degree curve of 1 means that between the points it's always going to be a straight line. So even if I had 3 points, 1, 2, 3, we'll number these, 1, 2, 3. If it's a degree of 1, I'm going to have a line that, or a curve that goes like that. Okay. If it's a degree of 2, I'll be able to arc through those two curves. Okay. A degree of 3 would be if this point is not coplanar. Right? So I'd end up with a curve that goes up and then back down, for example. So for right now, I'm working only in the two dimensions. So a degree of 2 would be just fine, right, with 5 points. And I do want to make sure that I check the box for delete input because I don't want to keep my original curve. Obviously, I'm replacing my original curve. And I'll go ahead and say OK. Okay, it looks essentially the same. Except that now, if I turn on my points, we see that I have 5 points controlling this curve instead of just the 2 that I had before. Okay, this then allows me to select one of these points and I can click and drag and I can change this cushion to have a little bit of, let me get a little closer here, a little bit of wave on one side here. Something like that. Okay. So now, where I used to have a nice straight line, right, I have something with just a little bit of a wander to it, which is nice. Okay? So let me go ahead and I'm going to do that to these other curves as well. So let me take each one of those, and I'm going to go up again to the Edit menu and go to Rebuild. And I'm going to change the point count to 5 with a degree of 2, and I'll go ahead and say OK. Now I'm doing it on all three of those at once because I can rebuild them all at once. Okay? Then I can turn all of the points on. There they are. And we can start to adjust these a little bit as well. So let me zoom in a little bit. Right, and we can pull this out. And pull that back. Part of it, and part of the reason that I like dragging here, you guys know that I'm generally very move from point to point. In something like this, this is actually probably a good place for the gumball to exist. Right, where we do little like small adjustments, as much as I hate the gumball, because we're just making it look what looks right. Right, there's not a right answer. It's if you look at a couch cushion, it doesn't stick out by a quarter of an inch here and an eighth inch there. It just sticks out a little bit. Right, so we're working with those little bits right now. Right, and so I'll just come around and I'll tweak these a little bit, something like that. Nothing too extreme. Right, we don't need it to be too extreme. Right? So maybe something like that. And so if we start to look at this cushion, it's not so strict anymore. It's not so straight anymore. Right? So this is a good starting place. Okay, so the other thing that happens if I start to do this, and this is something that long term is going to be a problem for me, is I really need the two objects here to come together at a single point. Right? And so I'm going to go ahead and delete these fillets for right now. And I'm going to go ahead and turn the points back on these objects. And I'm going to make these two points come together at a single point. So let me turn off the gumball here. Right? And we'll move this a little bit over. And then I'm actually going to, here I'm coming back to my move command, and I'm going to move these two points so that they coincide on top of each other. I do have point, or I will have point checked. And let me do that for each of these corners. And I know that the corners aren't quite as soft as they were, but I'm going to deal with that in just a second. So let me turn those points on. All right, we'll move this down. And again, because this is not a precise object, I don't mind if the corner's not exactly on the point, right? I'm looking for general size. But I do want to make sure that they're on top of each other. So there and there. All right, let's drag this down a little bit more. Move there and there. And you could actually not do the fillet initially. That might save you a step because it's unnecessary. I was just trying to show you the process by which this kind of thing happens. Okay, so now I have these, and they're coming together a little bit sharp. I'd like to change these so that they're not so sharp, but I may end up needing to rebuild the curves to be even finer, so I have more control over my points to do this. So for example, I have these two. If I were to turn them on, right, I can't really round this over because I need a point that's much closer here. Right? So I have a couple options. I could take the curve, and we'll do it for both of these, and I could once again go up to my edit and then rebuild. And I could stand instead of 5, maybe I do 12. I say OK. And now if I were to turn the points on there, now I have points that are much closer. Right? Now notice that I didn't turn my points on to 12 when I did the initial changes because I wanted them to be kind of broad changes. If I had 12 and I tried to create this curve, it would be very hard to create a smooth curve because I have too many points to try to move. Does that make sense? Right? So you can always rebuild back and forth to get what you want. So in this case, I have points that are fairly close. I'm going to select both of the endpoints there. So I dragged a box around both endpoints. And now I'm going to drag these endpoints together. Oh, let me turn off ortho for a second. And at a certain point, they're going to start to make a nice curve. Okay. The other option that I have is I can do something called inserting a knot. And I always forget where it is. It's insert knot. I don't know where it is in the menu structure. It's probably here somewhere. It's probably under curve. I don't know. Anyway, insert knot. And what insert knot is, it says select curve or surface for knot insertion. So I'll select that. And then see how I get a slider that goes along the length of the curve? I can come in here and actually set a control point right there on the edge of the curve. So I could do the same thing with this curve and create a point right there. Now when I'm done, it all goes away because I have to actually show the control points. And when I do that, it should show me, well, I zoomed in a little too far. You know, there's one, and there's the one that I just created. Okay? So maybe that was a little bit too tight. But the point is that if I create these knots, I could also delete the knot. Remove knot. Right? I could get rid of that particular knot because I was zoomed in too far. Anyway, the point being that you can choose where you want to put the extra control points, should you need to. Okay?
By adding a knot.
By adding a knot. So I'm going to pull these down like this, right, to smooth out that edge. And then we'll come down here. And let me go ahead and turn them all on. And we'll do that. Looks like I failed to rebuild these two curves. Let me rebuild those real quick. 12. And then let's show them. There. And there. Okay, so now what started out as a rectangle is now starting to be much looser in its boundaries, right? Wouldn't you guys agree?
A little bit.
Okay. So let's start to think about this instead of in its two-dimensional form. Let's start to think about it in its three-dimensional form. So we started in the top view, but now let's look at it in the perspective view. So it's still perfectly flat. Okay? What if I start to add a little bit of dimension in the up and down? Okay? So let's take these curves. Let's turn our points on, right? And I'm going to take a few of these points. On each side. And then it's a little bit easier to do this in the side view, right? I'm going to go to move and I'm going to pull them up a little bit. I could also type move vertical.
You pick your points on the top view?
I picked my points in the perspective just so that I could see which points I was picking. And then I'll pick a few of the other points. I'm holding down shift as I pick them. And we'll move these guys down a little bit. So I'll go to move. And I'm doing it in the side view so that I don't have to type V for vertical. And now if we start to look at this, right, it's not a perfectly flat curve anymore. Okay, so I warped it, so to speak, in the top view. Then I warped it in this view a little bit. Right, because fabric has a little bit of undulation to it. So now let's go ahead and take this curve, and I'm going to copy it vertically. So I'll type copy or go to edit, or excuse me, transform, and then copy, turn on vertical, and I want to go up by, we'll say, 4 inches, the thickness of this cushion. Okay. So now I have two copies of these two, right? But in reality, the top of the cushion isn't necessarily going to be exactly the bottom of the cushion. So I'd come back to these upper curves, I'd turn my points back on, and I'd select different groupings of these. Notice that I'm kind of staying away from the corners, right? I'm doing the undulations in the middle of the span. And so let's go ahead and move them. I'll move them down a little bit. And now that upper one is different than the bottom one. I would spend, if I were doing this, I would spend a little bit more time really thinking about which parts need to go up or back. Okay, so now I have an upper curve and I have a lower curve. Okay, I'm going to create, right, a few more curves for my reference. The first one that I'll do is just, it's just a regular polyline, and I'm going to go from right here to right there. Those are the two points in the corner. And I'll hit enter. And I'll come over here and I'll do the same thing from there to there, enter. And from there to there, enter. And this one's wrapped around a little bit further. And from there to there, enter. Okay? So you can start to see that what I've created is an outline with these curves of what the shape that I ultimately want to create. I haven't worked with surfaces. Okay? So now I really wanted to actually create the surface. And if I did something like a loft from one surface to the other, for example, it would build a surface that had some undulations in it, but it's always going to be straight from here to here. Well, cushions don't really work that way, right? They're not really straight. So we need another strategy for how we build this surface. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up to Surface, and I'm going to use something called a curve network. And a curve network is a grouping of curves. They're not actually a group, but it's a selection of curves that end up making or defining a surface. And we're going to start with the most basic curve network. And it's going to say select curves in the network. And I'm going to do a surface for the top. And I'm going to pick the four bordering curves. Okay. When I do that and I hit enter, it will automatically sort the curves into their directions because of how I did this geometry. It will give me sides A, B, C, and D, and then it will let me choose some options. I'm going to use the default options for right now, and when I say OK, I'm going to get a surface that isn't flat in either direction. So it's using those borders to define what's happening on the curve itself, or on the surface itself. Okay. So there's a few rules about the curve network. And that is, one, you have to have curves that go all the way around the outside of whatever the surface is that you're trying to create. So when I'm doing it, I have to have
One, two, three, four.
Okay. There's a rare case where you could actually do it with three, but it's a little bit trickier. Okay. So I have to have that. Okay. And I have to have these points have to be exactly on top of each other. Okay. I cannot have one of these lines go past the point and have it make the curve network. Right. So it has to be completely an object like this. Okay. Furthermore, I can't have an object, right, a separate curve. So there's a point here, a separate curve here, and then like this, and a separate curve, or something like this. This won't work as part of the curve network. What we're looking for is curves that go in two directions. So this curve here goes in one direction. This curve here also goes in that direction, right? There and there. And then this curve there goes in the second direction and the second direction. Okay. The cool thing is I can add curves to this. I could add a curve in here, right? And as long as it's going in the second direction, it's legal, right? Likewise, I could add a curve here, and as long as this is going in the first direction, it's legal. And I'm going to do this in just a second. The only other critical part is these two have to intersect. They can't be separate. So any point where curves intersect has to have a point. Okay? Yeah. Right, right. So it's specific about that. And there's ways around it. If you really wanted a hexagon, you can do it bigger and then trim it off to make the hexagon later. But anyway, so let's say I want to take this a step further. Okay. So let's say that I want to add a curve that goes straight across here. So I'll pick midpoint. And we'll jump across, something like that. Now, because this snapped to this point and to that point, it's an okay curve. And I could, in fact, right, go ahead and do a curve network with all of these points. And it would build a surface with this line being perfectly flat. Okay? But I don't want that because it defeats the purpose of the cushion. Right? And actually, I'd like to add a few more lines. Right? I'd like one to be somewhere in here. Right. Sometimes you end up having to do the nearest. Let me do. See if I can do not. No.
So you can just at random pick a knot, and then that's your point.
Exactly. Exactly. There's near. Sorry, couldn't find near. I need near just so that I'm on the curve, right? And then I can come over here and I can go on that curve, and I'll do one more over here. To right there. Now, I'm deliberately not going to put one across the center, right? Instead, I'm just going to work with these in this direction. I'll do one later where I go across the center, but it's much harder. As soon as you add a curve in the opposite direction, it's harder, okay? So, I have these on. Let's go ahead and rebuild these. And we don't need 12. I don't know, let's maybe do 6, right? And, oops. Sorry, I only need these three. And we'll do them by 6, and I'll say OK. Then I'll turn those points on. There's my 6 points. Okay. So let's say that I wanted there to be a bit of a depression right back in here where somebody was sitting on it. Okay. So let's take this point, and this point, right? And I'll turn on my gumball, and I'll move those down a bit. Okay. And then I'll take the middle point, and I'll move that down a little bit further. Right? Maybe I'll be a little reactionary, and this will come up a little bit like that. Right? Maybe this one comes up a little bit like that. Right? Maybe these two, because they're part of like where the legs might go, maybe they have to go down a little bit too. And this is where how you observe what's happening in real life can matter. Right? So if you look at a cushion, you can get a better sense of what's really happening and what these control curves could be. So now I can take, once again, turn off gumball, and I can take these curves, and I can go to surface curve network and say OK. And lo and behold, it's following all of these curves. So it matches up on the edges, certainly, But you can also see that I was able to create that depression in the center. So this is starting to look much more like a squishy object, right, than something that was just the square object that I started with. Now let's take it a step further in how these start to wrap around the edges. So this curve plus this, this, and this also make a curved network. Okay? So let's take this and this and rebuild them. And we don't need 6 segments. Maybe we'll do 3 segments. And I'll say OK. Let me show my control points so that I have this. And I'm going to do this in the top view because it's a little bit harder to do. And I'm going to move that out slightly. And you can see it happening in the perspective view at the same time. But it's easier to control this so that it's going directly away from the corner. Right? And then we'll come back and we'll do this one. Same thing. I'll move it, and I'm going to move it directly away from the corner. Like that. And so now you can see how that's then pushing out. It's bulging out a bit. Now, since the person was sitting here and they kind of have a butt depression there, I want to push out even a little bit more in the center, right, to compensate. So we'll go right from the midpoint here, we hope, to maybe right there. And again, it only matters that it's part of the same, it's connected to those two lines. And let me go ahead and turn on once again, or I have to rebuild. And we'll do 3 points, and then let me show those points, and then let me move this point out. And I'm going to push this one out just a little bit further, right, to compensate for the fact that there's squishing happening here. Okay, so again, about observation more than anything else. Then I can take these objects. Oops, I need the curve, not the object here. There it is. There and there, and I'll go up to my surface curve network. Okay, and now I've built that side of the object. Notice that they match up right along that edge because the curve is defining that edge. Okay, so I can continue on. I'm not going to do as much work on the sides because you get the idea, but I can take each of these sides, same thing there, go to surface curve network. One more time. And one last time for underneath here. I'll say okay. And now I have a cushion. Right, looks better from the back because of the bulge in it. That looks reasonably like an organic type shape. Okay, and so with some observation, you can end up creating virtually anything that you want. Now, in this particular instance, right, if I were going to end up having this, I'd have to think about how the texture would apply to something like this. Right. So let's go ahead and create a layer here. Well, I'm already on this. Let me load in some kind of a cloth. Go to V-Ray, material editor. I'm going to load a material off my flash drive here. And I probably have something called fabric somewhere, right? And I have a lot of different options. I'm going to pick the black and white swirl for right now. There's the swirl, okay? And so let me go ahead and apply this to the layer. There. And now if I were to turn it on, or excuse me, turn it to rendered mode, we'd see that I have the fabric being applied to this particular object. Okay? It's a little bit challenging for how this comes together because obviously I have to think about it as individual pieces of fabric. And so we have two different options. We could take all of the pieces at once, like that, and we could go to our properties, we could go to our texture mapping. It's roughly a box, right? And so we could apply a bounding box, world, yes, and create an x equals y equals z, and we could have essentially fabric that was reasonably applied to it, right? But in this context, it's clearly this piece of fabric is a different piece of fabric from that, as is this, right? And we may or may not be happy with how this ends up looking, okay? We can, instead of doing it that way, we could apply, I'm going to delete the layer mapping there, we could end up applying individual mapping using surface mapping to each individual surface and then controlling each surface separately, right? Which can sometimes give us more more control, such that we could, for example, let me turn on the mapping widget for this one. Let me do a planar instead. Let me get these, and let me do a planar mapping on this one. Hunting box, world. And so I have different control over this particular object, right? The scale's not quite right. Go maybe 5. Right, maybe I have to show the mapping so we can see, okay, I'm projecting down. I would need to adjust that. Let me go to my gumball. And obviously I repeated the pattern too many times, so maybe I go back to 1. But the point is now I can have some much finer control of independent parts of this, right? So it's just a different way of electing how to do the mapping. Anyway, it doesn't matter. One of the things that can help this, I'm going to go back and do a box mapping on all of this. Hide the mapping. Do a box mapping. There we go. So we're back to that. Oh, and let me do x equals y equals z. Just so that the fabric looks consistent. But we have this transition of the fabric. So maybe it would be nice to put a little bit of piping along the edge there. So let me go ahead and draw a circle right here. And I want this circle, right, to be a specific diameter. Maybe it's a quarter inch. Okay, so there it is. Now, I need to use Rotate 3D to get it into the proper kind of orientation. So I'll do Rotate 3D. And this may need multiple views to establish correctly. So I'll start here, and I want to be essentially perpendicular. And then perpendicular that way, such that I can pull it up in that direction. Okay, so see how it's at 45 degrees to what I'm doing? Now I can take and sweep one, right? This around that, such that I create a little piping that follows along the edge of that. Okay. Now, I may need to do it as, continue all the way around and do it. I might be able to get away with doing a chain. I'll try it for just a second. Let me do a sweep, 1, chain edges, so that I can make my rail more than 1 cross-section curve, it would be this one, and we'll go ahead and make my piping. So now I have that little bit of piping that goes all the way around, which can really kind of hide that seam nicely. Okay, so you get the idea, right? I could do the same thing down below and put the little piping around that as well. We're going to always have issues at these edges, right, for how they come together and how the texture mapping is applied. This seam here has to do with the box mapping. It may take a little bit of adjustment to get that spot on perfect. But we're certainly getting there. Okay, so that's making more of a couch cushion styled object. But what if I wanted to make something like a throw pillow instead? Okay, and obviously I'm going to keep going off on tangents and showing you more and more different things at this point. This is kind of the bulk of what we're looking for today in terms of, I want you to do a curved network. That's the skill you need to learn. But I have to show you different things because life is boring if I don't, right? So let's go back to shaded mode, right? We'll go ahead and turn off my default layer, which was that first one, and I'm going to start working on the second one. But I'm going to work in black just because you guys will be able to see it a little bit better. Yeah.
If you went back and delete those curves after you did them, just so that they don't show the black lines, it would affect the object?
No. No. When you go to render it, it only renders the surfaces anyway. Okay, so let's say that I want to do a like a throw pillow, like a couch throw pillow or something, right? So I'll start at the origin, and maybe the throw pillow is, I don't know, 16 by 16, right? Something like that. So once again, right, I'm going to take this, I'll explode it, and then I'll rebuild it. And I don't know, maybe we'll rebuild it by sides will be relatively consistent. Let's go ahead and jump forward into maybe like 8. Let me turn my points on. There we go. I'm going to adjust each of these corners the same way I did before. I'm going to use move because the gumball drives me nuts. And just round off these corners. If you wanted sharp corners, that's fine. Again, it's a personal preference as to what you're after. Okay, so now I have that kind of established. It would be nice if I adjusted these a little bit more so that they weren't quite perfect, right? Maybe the center comes in a little bit. Maybe this one goes out just a little bit. And a lot of this is subtle changes. So you guys know, like movies like Pixar and stuff that are animated movies, you know that there's a person whose job it is to make things dirty, right? Because if they don't do it, if you look at some of the really early Pixar movies or like some of their precursor cartoons and stuff, surfaces are too perfect, right? That's one of the problems with computer rendering is stuff is, it just looks too good. And so there is actually people, their job is to go in and make things scratched and dirty and match what real life surfaces are, which is why a lot more of the rendered animated movies today look so much better because of these people that dirty things up. It's kind of interesting, right? So we're essentially trying to dirty things up by changing these edges a little bit. Okay, so in this context, right, I have my surrounding. I could adjust it so that it wasn't quite so flat. I don't really care because it's not about what we're doing right now. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a curve that goes directly across from end to end there, and another one that goes from end to end right there.
That automatically goes to okay.
I had not turned on, so it was snapping. I could turn it off, and then it would go to just end. It was actually end, comma, not, so it was both. Okay, so now if I looked at these two curves, gumball needs to go off or it's going to drive me nuts. I can then take these two curves and I can rebuild them, but I want to be very careful about the center of these two curves because I'm going to use them as kind of a unit in this context. So I'm not going to pick an even number here. I have to pick an odd number, right? Because I want there to be one point at the center. So if I picked, say, 5, and then I showed my points, you see that there is a point in the center. They're not quite perfectly in the center because the two curves are different lengths because I shortened the corners. Okay? But in this context, I want to make sure that they're directly on top of each other. So I'll take one of these and move it so that it's exactly on top of the other, like that. Right? So that those two points come together. Assuming that those two points are together, right, I can then turn these back on and I can start to work with these as control points. So let's go ahead and move all of them vertically. And why is it not doing what I want it to do? It's always fun when you do it live and stuff doesn't work, right? Let's go move. There we go. That's what I wanted it to do. But I need to do it this way. Not like that. Let's take this one. And again, probably a good job for the gumball. Maybe not. Okay, so I've created a bit of a dome to this particular shape. Right? Now I could lessen the dome a little bit on one side. I could push this down so it's not quite perfect. right? Maybe this one is just a little bit off. I don't know. Maybe this one's a little bit higher because it's lopsided. Pillows are always slightly lopsided, so maybe a little bit more there. Anyway, you get the idea. Notice those two points are staying consistent, right, which is critical. So now I can come back in here and I can do my curve network, which, by the way, the command, it's one of the few commands that's different than what it's called. It's called a network surface if you type it in. Otherwise, it's a curve network in the menu structure. Go figure. And so I have lines going in multiple directions. So this gets complicated. Okay. So I have a line that's going this way, right? And I have a line that's going this way. And obviously, I have a line that goes this way and this way. But I have lines that are going that way. So which direction do these lines go? Right? Well, unfortunately, they don't quite go in the right direction. So I need to get more creative about this. So if I take this curve and I take this curve and I join them into one closed curve, I have a curve that's going essentially in this direction. That curve is going in this direction. And this curve, if I join them, is going in that direction. Okay? This curve is going in the opposite direction. So now I can go and do a network surface, or a curve network, with 1, 2, 3, and 4. Notice that I get results. I get an A and a C. Right? I probably should have done this. Hold on a second. Let me break those apart again so that you can see what would happen if it was individual. Okay? So let me take these and say, oh, I'm going to go and do a curve network. It's going to say, wait a minute, unable to sort curves. Select curves one at a time. Right? Select first curve in first direction. Okay? So here's a big problem because I don't really have. So there's what happens. So if I take these two and I join them together, and I take these two and I join them together, right? Now I've got direction, 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 one in the cross direction. Now I can go up to my surface curve network. I can pick my objects there, and it will then build that side of the pillow for me. Okay? Now, if I wanted a little bit more control, right? Remember, as long as I rebuild these so that they're in odd numbers, right, we could say maybe do 9. I'll show my points. Again, I have those points right at the center, but they're not quite on anymore because I rebuilt them. So I need to move those so that they're spot on each other, point and point. Now I could take the, oops, one too many escapes, sorry. I could take this center point, and I could move that center point down a little bit to create a depression in the center of this pillow. And then once again, I could do my curve network, surface, curve network. And now I would have a little depression in the center of it. So you can see how I can keep working. The key is that those two points in the center have to be on top of each other, right? It won't work if they aren't. Okay? I should actually probably go back and do it where they weren't there. But anyway, you get the idea. Okay? Now, maybe in the center of this, right? For the ease of doing this, I'm just going to take these two and I'll mirror them so that they're underneath there. And then I can actually create the whole pillow. Right? In reality, I should adjust the ones underneath so that they're a little bit different. That's the nature. Every line should be a little bit different. But let's go ahead and do the same thing here. There's one. There's the other half, right? And they come together. I could do the same little piping around the edge if I wanted to, right? It depends on what you want the pillow to look like. The other thing is this pillow is kind of coming to a point, right? Sometimes you want it to come a little bit more rounded, in which case I would go back to, right, these curves. And again, I can turn my points on, and I could take this point. And let's see if I can do this so you guys can see it. And I can pull it out so that it's coming like that. This, I got it slightly out of plane, but you'll still be able to see it, which is where sometimes you kind of can't help but do this in multiple views at once. So there it is, getting a little bit wider. Maybe it needs a little bit more. Anyway, once I do the curve network of these, the pillow changes in its shape a bit. So let's take this, this, this. By the way, it doesn't matter when you're doing the curve network what order you select the curves in. It will automatically sort them. So now this is coming down a little bit softer, as not quite as pointy. So you have to kind of pay attention to how you want these things to come together as part of the pillow. I could, if I wanted to, I could create a little like ellipsoid right here in the middle. Let's see if I can get knot back on here. I want the center. Hold on, I have to do this with one of my other options here. Let's see. Sphere, let me do point, first point. No, I want center, hold on. From center. I should do this in the top view. Anyway, the button turned out the wrong direction, right? Because I snapped the wrong way. The point is that I can, let me just do it over here on the side. I could take something like this. Come on.
Oh, you're making buttons you put on there?
Yep. And I could stick it right there. And now it has a little button in the center. I mean, anyway, you get the idea. Okay? So you can keep kind of playing with these things, and as long as the geometry starts to match, you can see that you can build almost anything. Okay? Now what about, I told you I'd keep escalating what I was doing. What about if we wanted to do some curtains? Okay? So curtains are a little bit more tricky. Right? So let's come over here in space, and I'm going to draw two lines. I'll start with a line there, and in reality I should measure these lines, but it doesn't really matter. Okay, let me take this curve, and I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to copy it vertically, and we'll say we'll go up, I don't know, 8 feet. So I have the top and the bottom of the curve. Now I need to rebuild these curves to match the number of folds that would be part of this particular curtain. So let me go ahead and we'll rebuild, and I don't know, this is probably a lot. We'll say this is maybe 30. And then we'll turn our points on. And you see that I have lots of little folds. Okay? What I'm going to do is I'm going to select every other curve. Right? So we'll start here. We'll select this one. Oh, gumball's got to go off. And I'll select every other. Right? Like that. And I'm going to move this that direction. So you see I'm starting to create that wave pattern. Okay? Let's take the opposite side here. And I specifically did not select either endpoint, right? Because I want the endpoints to end up being in the center of this. Okay? So now I have a wave. Notice that I rebuild both of these at the same time, so they have the same number of control points. Okay? Now, if I wanted, right, I can also take a line and I can go from here to there. And I can take a line and I can go from here to there. So we have a straight line here. In reality, this one probably needs a little bit of that same curve treatment because the up top, it's going to have a similar thing. So to save time so that you don't have to watch me do it independently, I'm just going to copy this again up to the top. Okay, so we have the top and we have the bottom, right? And if I were to do a network surface out of these, curve network, okay, I'd end up with a rather nice little curtain. Okay, relatively easy. Okay, but wait a minute. this would be the curtain closed. But what if I wanted the curtain open where it was kind of swept back and held? Okay? Well, this is the fun of life, right? So, we can do the same essential thing, but we're going to tweak a few things. Number one, I'm going to take this curve, and I'm going to scale it, scale 1D, and I'm going to take this from that point, and I'm going to make this shorter, something like that. Maybe it needs to be a little bit shorter still. I'm using the scale 1D because it's scaling it not in the width, just in the length. Right. Did it scale? Yeah, hold on a second. Scale 1D from there to there. And see how the width is staying the same? I'm just compressing how the folds are coming together. Right. So let's put it, I don't know, maybe right there. Okay. Now at the same time, let's take this vertical curve, right, and let's rebuild that vertical curve. So I'm going to rebuild. I don't need 30 points. I need probably, we'll call it 3 points. Okay. If I were to turn the points on, I get 1, 2, and 3. Let's take this point and move it so that it's there. Right. And so you can see where this is going. Right. But in reality, this needs to come over a little bit more as well. So let me take this point. And we'll see how we want to do that. Yeah, I don't know. You know what? Let's pull it this way a little bit. Hold on a second. Stop jumping. Right, maybe like that. And now, if I were to do this, right, I could take this curve. I could go to surface, curve network. And my curtain would be being pulled back down here. Okay. Now, in reality, we might have the curve coming down and then hanging more straight in this section. So you can see that I'm constantly working to tweak this a little bit. So let's take this one. And actually, I want to scale this back up a little bit because I was a little bit too... Well, no, I'll scale this one down to open it. Take this, and let's pull this back a little bit. And let's move this back to here. Let's take this point, and this time I'm going to move this almost to that, or maybe a little bit further. Maybe like this. Okay, as if it were being held back. Okay. Now, when I do this, curve network, right, I've managed to compress this. Well, it looks like I did it. I was off a little bit. You can see how easily you can tweak things a little bit. I've managed to compress it such that it's being held back by some kind of a tie in here. And if I were to draw in the tie, it would make a lot more sense. Okay. So the point is that I have a lot of flexibility with what I can do in something like this. This is a sheet. Let me adjust that one. I'm a little unhappy that it got out of plane here. Okay, let's do it like this. And we'll do a sweep. One. Oh, excuse me. Whoops. Network surface. My brain all day has been talking about sweeps somehow in my mind. So I've been stuck on that. Okay, so, you know, looks kind of neat. You can see obviously where you can go with this. What about if I wanted a curtain rod to go through here? Why not, right? Let me take this, and I'm going to look at it in this view for a second, right, so that I'm kind of looking straight on at it. It may be helpful to see this in shaded mode, right? Here is my curtain, and it's a little bit off because I had the two endpoints meet up right in the center, so I'd ultimately have to clean this up a little bit. But let's say that I had a curtain, and I wanted to, maybe the holes in the curtain are 1.5 inches. This is in diameter, good. All right, something like that. Let me move this
right over on top of the object. And I told you there was going to be a problem there. Now, we talked a little bit about this before, way back when. I'm going to use the project command. Okay, so I'll be in the front view. I'll type project. I'm going to select that circle that I just created, not the top. Go away. Okay, and I want to project it through this. Lo and behold, see I get all those little circles? Like that. Now let's go ahead and use those circles, and I'll use trim, and we're just going to really quickly get through. Like that. And if we were to look at this, right, I now have circles that go all the way through as part of my little drape setup. Okay. Now I probably need a curtain rod in there too, so let's go ahead and there's my circle. I'm going to do it in this side view. Oops. We'll just wing it. Right. I said it was an inch and a half, so let's do an inch and a quarter there. And you know, for the fun of it, I could change this so that the profile was a little bit different and I could sweep it, but you guys don't need to watch me do that as much as I have fun doing these sorts of things, right? So let's go ahead and let's move this. Stop snapping. Sorry. Like that. And it's probably way over here in space, so I probably need it to be a little bit closer to my object. Like that. Let me copy this to the other side of the curtain. Like that. And I can take this, and I could loft them together. And we'd end up with the curtain on the curtain rod. Okay? So, the point is that this is meant for you to have some fun with it, right? I could, as I'm looking at this, I think I'd rather rebuild this curve one more time with maybe 5 points so that I could have this upper part hang more straight like that and have a little bit more of a billow to it, and then we could rebuild this again. And that might feel a little bit better from a gravity standpoint. You know, you kind of have to think about what you want it to look like. Now, I had a little problem because what I cut through, these all don't match up again, so I'd have to reproject because I just recreated it. So it's kind of a, you know, goes back and forth. But you get the idea. Okay. So obviously, I'm not anticipating that you're going to be creating curtains and everything. We're talking about one simple organic shape. But I want you to think about what this curve network does in defining one of these complex shapes with a few of these control curves, right? That's the idea today. Okay? Any questions?
Not yet.
All right.